I'm on top of the world, hey. I'm on top of the world, hey. Waiting on this for a while now. Paying my dues to the dirt. I've been waiting to smile, hey. Been holding it in for a while, hey. Take you with me if I can. Been dreaming of this since a child. Welcome, Paleo ladies and Paleo men. Welcome to the kingdom of the she-shells, the Malas. Malas with a K, or Malas with a C, or Malaska are what we commonly refer to as she-shells. They have long had an important role in human society, in everything from food to money to decoration. Malas can come in a variety of shapes and sizes. While most malas have shells, others don't have one. Basic body plans varies among malas, but there are features that most members of the same phylum share. Most malas have a fleshy and segmented body, which is usually elongate and symmetrical with a distinct head and tail end. The head contains the brain and the sensory structures. The mouth features a ribbon-like string of tiny teeth called the radula. The lower part is basically a foot used for crawling, burrowing, or swimming. It's the fleshy covering of the body which secretes the calcareous shell. The gills occupy the inner chamber within the mantle cavity. The perius cracum is the blackish organic layer on the outside of the shell. The core of the shell contains two or more layers of calcite prisms. They may have an aqueous layer made of aragonite. Pearls may be made of calcite, aragonite, or both. As you can see in this picture, an abalone shell called the mother of pearls exhibits an iridescent luster. It is an aqueous layer made of aragonite. Macology is a scientific study of malas. Now, where does the word malas came from? Latin word molluscus means soft in allusion to the soft bodies of shellfish. In ancient Rome, a mollusca was kind of a soft nut with a thin but hard shell. British scientists used the word mollus with the C, while some German and American scientists, as well as Webster's dictionary, prefer to spell mollus with a K. But the adjective for describing mollus is still spelled molluscan with a C. Carl Linnaeus formalized the term mollusca for a wide spectrum of soft-bodied invertebrates, including not only cephalopods, slugs, theropods, but also tunicates, anemones, medusae, echinoderms, brachiopods, and poliquiates. But he placed other groups such as bivalves, shelled gastropods, chitons, nautiloids, barnacles, and serpulid worms separately in Testacea. The modern concept of mollusca that includes bivalves, gastropods, and cephalopods but excludes anemones, medusae, and echinoderms all essentially date back to Georges Cuvier. The taxonomy or grouping and the naming of mollusks has become confusing due to amateur macologists and shell collectors who frequently name new species based on image or appearance and not geologic or biologic considerations like scientists do. Furthermore, scientific authors would use differing words for the same taxonomic rank, while biologists and paleontologists would use a different name for bivalves. The phylum Mollusca belongs to the domain of Eukarya in the kingdom Animalia. The phylum consists of three major subphylums, Amphinura, Certosoma, and Diasoma. These three are then divided into class and subclass, which are then divided into order, family, genus, and finally, the individual species. The subphylum Amphinura consists of three classes. The first one is called Fovieta, a small worm-like shell-less group that live upside down in burrows on the seafloor. They have about 70 living species, but no fossil record. The second one, Aplacora, or bearing no shell in Greek, also known as Solenogasters, are worm-like shell-less mollusks that live in and around cnidarians in water deeper than 200 meters. Although they have no external shell, they have internal spicules made of calcite. They have about 250 living species, but almost no fossil record. One well-known species of the class Polyplacophora are the chitons. The chitons are familiar from the rocks of tide pools, where they cling with their broad muscular foot and scrape algae off the rocks with their radulae, or mouth, which are made of magnetite or iron oxide. Unlike other mollusks, their shells are divided into an armor of 8 overlapping plates surrounded by a broad muscular band of mantle known as the girdle, and also by a ring of nerves surrounding the body. Presently, there are about 600 live species. After a chiton dies, its plates tend to break up and disassociate, so their fossil record is meager with only about 100 species found. And finally, we move on to the second subphylum, Certosoma. The class Monoplacophora were long known only as early Paleozoic fossils until a living species was discovered in 1952. Most Monoplacophorans have limpet-like, cup-shaped shells, but their segmented soft anatomy is much more primitive than any limpet. Although only 11 species in 3 genera survive today, they were an important group in the early experimental phase of molluscan evolution, with 39 genera in the Cambrian and 18 genera from the Ordovician, Silurian, and Devonian, after which the group was thought to be extinct. The living Monoplacophoran species, Neophelina galatae, showed a faint segmentation of gills, kidneys, hearts, gonads, and muscles, suggesting that mollusks arose from segmented worms, but then lost their segmentation. As you can see in this figure, this is Neophelina galatae. The largest mollusk class, Gastropoda, consists of about 40,000 to 100,000 living species of snails and slugs, and many thousands of fossil species. Gastropods have a long foot along which they creep. Most have a head with eyes and tentacles, and their mantle usually secretes a shell. Three subclasses are recognized. The subclass Prosobranchia consists of most shelled marine shells. The subclass Opisthobranchia consists of sea slugs, sea hares, and nudibranch. Finally, the subclass Pulmonata consists of land snails and slugs. The most active and intelligent mollusk is the class Cephalopoda, which have a ring of tentacles around their mouth. They have sophisticated eyes, a beak, and a brain suited for predatory lifestyle. Their mantle cavity is modified for jet propulsion backwards, but some can also swim forward. Primitively, cephalopods had conical shells divided into chambers. Although many groups lost their external shell, it only had an internal stiffening rod like a spine, or maybe no shell at all. Today, only the shelled chambered nautilus and the shell-less squids and octopuses survive, comprising of about 650 living species. But many thousands of extinct species, especially the ammonites, are known. The last of the three subphylums of mollusca is the subphylum Diastema. The only extinct class of mollusks is the class Rostoconcha, known for about 35 genera from the Cambrian to late Permian. They have a pseudo-bivalve shell with an anterior partition called the pegma and some also have a posterior pigma. The pigma connects the two halves and serves as the attachment site for the pedal retractor muscles. Since they are enclosed by two symmetrical valves, Rostocoughs look superficially like bivalves, but the lack of a ligament, bivalve-type adductor muscles, and many other features have led paleontologists to place them in their own class, thought to be ancestral to both bivalves and scaphopods. The second most common group is the class Bivalvia. They are clams, oysters, scallops, etc., which have enclosed bodies in a hinged calcareous shell. Consequently, they have lost their heads and most sense organs, and their foot is an axe-like wedge for burrowing. They also have expanded and modified their gills for both respiration and filter feeding. About 8,000 to 50,000 living species are known, but many more are known from the fossil record, 7,000 from the Paleozoic, 15,000 from the Mesozoic, and 20,000 from the Pre-Holocene Cenozoic. The class Scaphopoda, also known as the tusk shells, live in a long, conical, tapering, tubular shell, half buried in the sand, where they use their foot to dig and their tentacles to catch prey in the sand. Although never very diverse, nor variable on this simple body form, they are known as early as the Ordovician. About 350 species still survive today. Most are only a few centimeters in length, but some Pennsylvanian specimens were almost 60 centimeters long.